the historical roots of the rapidly expanding cult of Mary with the worship of ancient goddesses and other pagan practices have been examined in an earlier chapter. Such links now seem to strengthen what we assumed before, or even proved before. The New Age movement is undoubtedly advancing on many fronts, not least in the church, which will not endure sound doctrine having itching ears. Many Christians have drunk deep draughts of New Age potions. For example, holistic health, hypnosis, yoga, inner healing, meditation, psychical research and awareness training, and many have imbibed new doctrines and heresies based on the humanistic and positive thinking of Teilhard de Chardin, Norman Vincent Peale and others, which provide the Church with its emphasis on an earthly kingdom now, the social gospel and society reconstructed for Christianized with kingdom principles for the Lord's return. Restorationist leader Brin Jones, writing in the beginning of 1991, promised his followers that, quote, "By the power of his Spirit, we will bring all that is against God and man beneath Christ's authority. God's Church will be the most influential body of people on earth in the final period of this age." Unquote. This is indeed a prophetic word, but it is fulfilled in Scripture only by the apostate church of the Book of Revelation. Hello and welcome to another video from Juggler 66, Hour of the Truth. This one is called The Virgin Mary and deals with Chapter 3 of the wonderful book All Roads Lead to Rome, The Ecumenical Movement by Michael de Semlyen. We have had already two chapters and it's quite interesting to me to do this reading because I do that in German and English simultaneously, as you probably already know. And yesterday I recorded chapter 3 in German. That was for about an hour, including all my comments, so I hope that I will get into about the same time when I do the English recording right now. See if I have all the same comments, more or less, to fit a little bit the pictures in the video here. Anyway, this book, All Roads Lead to Rome, is actually, as you probably know, an answer to the question stated here. And we have already seen the first two chapters dealing with the background to ecumenism, the Roman Catholic doctrine and the Mass, and now we are going into the Virgin Mary. And for a deeper understanding of the Virgin Mary, I advise you, because I didn't read that in English, I read that in German, the book The Two Babylons from Alexander Hislop. I advise you to go to chapter 7 of Alexander Hislop's book, The Two Babylons, and the image of the beast. And there you will learn a lot about the Virgin Mary deception, as I like to call it, from the Roman Catholic Church. But without any further ado, I'm going to go continue reading on page 46 in the book, if you follow along in your own copy. In his book, A New Pentecost, Cardinal Sunens wrote, "Ecumenism has tended to play down Mary's role, but the renewal movement has marked out a place for her as the first charismatic." Unquote. Now, Cardinal Sunens is a Belgian who lived in Malines, or Malines, or however you pronounce it in English. It's called Mechelen here in Flemish, and it's about 30 kilometers from where I live here. We are so entrenched with Jesuits in this little country, Belgium, I can tell you it's not funny anymore. In fact, renewed evangelical churches have not been playing down Mary's role. On the contrary, many of them are also referring to her as the first charismatic, stressing her humanity, acknowledging the special role she played at Pentecost, and underlining her accessibility. This redressing of the balance or reinstatement of Mary's important place in the Bible in the strong ecumenical climate now prevailing is confusing and troubling ordinary church members who wish to hold on to clear and firm Protestant roots. Well, I have to make a little comment here. Is troubling to ordinary church members who wish to hold on to clear and firm Protestant roots. I wouldn't even call it Protestant roots. I would like to call it biblical roots. We have to understand that the so-called Reformation, the undertaking of all the so-called Protestants, of all the reformers, was a return to biblical Christianity. And why is that? Because they saw and they learned that the Roman Catholic Church is anything but biblical truth, anything but adhering to the true Word of God. So whenever the author writes here about Protestants, I would rather you to understand that those are people like me who adhere to the Bible and the Bible alone as the true Word of God, as he expresses it to us. Therefore, we don't need a priest, we don't need a bishop, and we surely do not need a pope to teach us what's in the Bible, because God used simple and plain words that all of us can understand it, especially when you read the King James Version of the Bible. So, what I mean is, when you have this movements, this evangelical movement, you have this ecumenical movement, you have this charismatic movement, you have all these movements where all the so-called separated brethren return back under the wings of Rome, that only means that they are giving up their stance of sola scriptura, the Bible and the Bible alone. So of course the author is right when he writes that this redressing of balance or reinstatement of Mary's important place in the Bible, where I don't see any important place of the Bible in the Bible of Mary, when I read through the whole Bible, she was just a vessel giving birth to the man Christ Jesus, to the God when he came onto this earth, and with that she fulfilled her task. Or reinstatement of Mary's important place in the Bible in the strong ecumenical climate now prevailing is confusing and troubling ordinary church members who wish to hold on to clear and firm Protestant roots, meaning Bible roots, meaning they want to adhere to the Word of God alone, without mixing the holy with the profane. Few evangelical churches as yet are as convinced as Cardinal Sunens, who in a New Pentecost later recalls that a brief mention stressing the role of Mary at an international charismatic conference in 1973 was met with a standing ovation, get this, from 20,000 persons. I felt like we were one family gathered in our home, around our mother. Wherever speaks the Bible of the church as being a mother. In the Bible, the church is a bride, a virgin, and not a mother. Pope John Paul II's reference to England was Mary's dowry. Well, get that. Pope John Paul's II reference to England as Mary's dowry received a similar rapturous response at Wembley Stadium during the papal visit in 1982. So this can only happen when people are betrayed and do not know the Bible. The Pope's observation reflects the unchanging Vatican position regarding the claim to papal suzerainty over England, which goes back to the time of King John. Again, I have to interrupt here a little bit. England's reference to Mary's dowry. You really have to understand that what the Pope teaches here. And then it goes on to say the Pope's observation reflects the unchanging Vatican position regarding the claim to papal suzerainty over England, which goes back to the time of King John. So the Pope, even though that England was for a long time Protestant, still has a suzerainty over England. Why is that? If you want to understand that, I am not a Seventh-day Adventist, but you have to watch the documentary from Walter Veit about the beamable and sustainable princess to get what he means here, where actually is laid out that the crown all the time is still in possession of the papacy. And how much that is true and really the case, I will probably go into a few Hour of the Truth or future Hour of the Truth videos that I'm going to make with my brother in Christ, Robert Newman from England, who knows a little bit more about that. But this is again a complete deception, because the Vatican thinks that he has, the Vatican regards the claim to papal suzerainty over England, which goes back to the time of King John. Now, very important sentence. John Paul's kissing of the ground on arrival was the sign of the historic claim that this country belongs to Mary and the Mother Church. Very important sentence. I hope you understand that very well. Tom Fress said that already when he was dealing with the papal visit of 2008, when Benedict XVI, Antichrist Benedict XVI, came to the United States of America and kissed the ground of America by arrival. And he said, this is a token, a sign, that that country is owned by the Pope. Now I hear it from the author, Michael de Semlyen, who says, John Paul's kissing on the ground on arrival was the sign of the historic claim that this country belongs to Mary and the Mother Church. So, when this country belongs, quote-unquote, belongs to Mary and the Mother Church, who is the head of the Church? The Pope, right? So, when the Pope is the head of the Church and he kisses the ground as a sign of a historic claim that this country belongs to Mary and the Mother Church, and he is the head of the Church, it belongs to him. So this is confirmation of everything that Tom Fress ever said on Inquisition Update from 2008, at least up to today, when he actually confirmed what Michael de Semlyen wrote in this book. Now, Professor Malachi Martin, who is described as a former Jesuit and who worked closely with the present Pope, John Paul II, that is, in the Vatican, confirms that the practice of kissing the soil of each nation the Pope visits is to consecrate that country to Mary, to whose service he is dedicated. Again, I make the same comment like I did before. When the Pope kisses the ground, giving the country to Mary, and he is the head of the Church, of which she is the mother, then the country belongs to the papacy. Simple as that. Now we will go into a little bit another reading, and I told you already before, I read the two Babylons in German to my German brethren. I didn't read that in English, but I read from Ralph Woodrow, Babylon Mystery Religion, and now we come to a subject that is called the Queen of Heaven, and that is dealt extensively in the book of Alexander Hislop, where we will read a little quote from here also, and it is also dealt, of course, in the book of Ralph Woodrow, Babylon Mystery Religion, with Pope Pius XII, Hitler's Pope, very important to understand, and if you want to learn more about that, go back to my book reading that I did on Behind the Dictators, that dealt a lot with Eugenio Pacelli, the papal nuncio in Germany between 1917 and 1929, the one who prepared the Concordat that was signed within the first 4 months of Hitler's grasping of power in Germany in 1933, and who became then later, after Pope Pius XI died, Pope Pius XII, Antichrist Pius XII, Eugenio Pacelli. A pope many today still remember described Mary as Queen of Heaven. He it was, on November 1st, 1950, who proclaimed infallibly ex cathedra that Mary's body was raised from the grave shortly after she died, and she was taken up and enthroned as Queen of Heaven. Unquote. Now, when the Pope speaks ex cathedra, means from the throne, and he speaks on dogma, on Roman Catholic dogma and theology, then the Pope speaks infallibly, meaning he cannot err. That was so set into Roman Catholic canon law at the First Vatican Council in 1870 by Pope Pius IX, Pio IX. And he states that Mary's body was raised from the grave shortly after she died, and she was taken up and enthroned as Queen of Heaven. Why don't we find anything of that in the Word of God, in the Bible? Because it is not there. The Bible does not venerate Mary, yeah, like the Roman Catholic Church does. At St. Peter's Square on Easter Day 1988, Pope John Paul II's message included a prayer to the Queen of Heaven for protection and peace in the world. The only references to be found in Scripture of the Queen of Heaven relate to the Canaanite pagan goddess to whom the Israelites burned incense, made cakes, and poured out drink offerings, and who was detestable and wicked in the eyes of the Lord, as we can read in Jeremiah chapter 44, verses 17 through 25, and chapter 7, verse 18. In the Two Babylons, Alexander Hislop identifies the worship of the Queen of Heaven of the Bible with that of Semiramis, who was the wife of Nimrod and worshipped by the Babylonians, as well as with the worship of the Assyrian goddess Astarte, of Diana of the Ephesians, of the Virgin Venus in pagan Rome, and many other Virgin Mother goddesses all over the world. Semiramis' son referred to in Scripture under the name of Tammuz, as we can read in Ezekiel chapter 8, verse 14, who met a violent death and for whom the woman wept, is identified with Osiris in Egypt and Bacchus in Rome. Mother and child, not only the child, but mother and child were worshipped in the popular religion of Babylon, represented in pictures and images as an infant or child in his mother's arms. Likewise, after the Tower of Babel, by many nations and peoples all over the world, in Egypt as Isis and Osiris, in India to this day as Isai and Aswara, in pagan Rome as Venus or Fortuna and Jupiter, even in Tibet, China and Japan. The Jesuit missionaries were astonished to find the counterpart of Madonna and her child as devoutly worshipped as in papal Rome itself. Xingmu, the Holy Mother in China, being represented with a child in her arms and a glory around her, exactly as if a Roman artist had been employed to set her up. And this ends the quote taken from Reverend Alexander Hislop's book, The Two Babylons, that I had to quote here. And this lays a little bit also the ground on a comment that I will make later on, that you see that in all these different nations, all these different peoples all over the world venerate mother and child, worship mother and child pictures. Very, very important. Pope Pius IX, who I'm already mentioned, Pio IX, whose contribution to the Church has been especially singled out for veneration by the present Pope, described Mary as, quote, Mary, Mother of God, who has destroyed all heresies throughout the world and who allows herself to be entreated by all, shows herself to be most clement towards all, and takes under her pitying care all our necessities with most ample affection, sitting as queen upon the right hand of her only begotten Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, in a golden vestment clothed around with various adornments. Unquote. From the encyclical letter of Pope Pius IX from the December of 1864. the same year, that same pope issued the Syllabus of Errors, condemning all governments by men, where men govern himself, like a democracy, for example. And I cannot help but go into this quote a little bit and turn you to the point where this is absolutely taken out of the Bible and turned around like anything. Did you understand that? Sitting as queen upon the right hand of her only begotten Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. Who was Jesus Christ the only begotten Son of? Who is Jesus Christ the only begotten Son of? God, the Father, and not Mary. Mary even had more children. We come to that later, but I just want to make a little bit the point here that you understand how when the Pope says things like this, and he quotes actually true Bible words, only begotten Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, and turns them around and takes it away from the glory of the Father and gives it to the Mother, Mary. Very, very important to read these things and to understand these things correctly. The author continues, certainly the flavor of such descriptions belongs more to Jeremiah's prophecy than to the New Testament's. Many photographs appear in the press of the present Pope praying in front of statues or images of the Virgin Mary. One such picture in the Daily Telegraph was of the Pope descending Mount Chitif in northwest Italy after climbing to the summit to pray at the statue of the Virgin Mary. Former Member of Parliament Geoffrey Cooper pointed out the scripture in the Gospel of John in which Jesus said to the Samaritan woman, quote, "You shall neither worship on this mountain nor yet at Jerusalem worship the Father. The true worshippers shall worship the Father in spirit and in truth, for the Father seeketh such to worship him," unquote, as we can read in the Gospel of John, chapter 4, verses 21 and 23. Not on a mountain, not at Jerusalem, and that also goes for today, you people who want to build a third temple, nor at Lourdes or Walsingham. There are no holy places, no special shrines, no holy water or sacred relics, no real presence. God is omnipresent and within every believer by his Spirit. Now, there's a very interesting quote Martin Luther did when I was reading the book Rulers of Evil. And Martin Luther said at that time, let me see that I can get that quote right out of my head because I don't have it written down here. He said that Jerusalem and all the Holy Land is as holy as the cows in Switzerland. And he was absolutely right about that. There is nothing holy. There are no holy places, as the author says here. There are no holy places, no special shrines, no holy water or sacred relics, no real presence. God is omnipresent and within every believer by his Spirit, who leads every one of his believers and followers. Mr. Cooper's entirely biblical response and concern over the increasing promotion of pilgrimages and of Mary worship has not yet found a voice within the press of this free nation. Why? Because we all know that through Miranda Prosus and Inter Mirifica, all press, all radio, all television, all social media is an inherent right to be owned by the Roman Catholic Church. So of course you will not read that in any so-called free press or press of a so-called free nation, free country, as Michael the Semlyen writes here. Jesus Christ is not Mary's only begotten Son. He is the only begotten Son of God. Nor is Mary Mother of God, nor indeed is she Mother of the Creator, Queen of Virgins, Ideal of Holiness, Throne of Knowledge, Source of our Joy, Queen of Peace, Rose of Heaven, Gate to Heaven, Radiant Tabernacle, Rock of David, Golden Temple, Morning Star, Heaven of the Sinners, Consolation of the Afflicted, Queen of Angels, Queen of the Apostles, Queen of the Martyrs, Queen of Paradise, or Queen of Heaven. She is neither of all this. Mary has the honored and distinguished place which Scripture accords to her. Not man, not the Pope, not the Roman Catholic Church. She has the honored and distinguished place which Scripture accords her. Quote, all generations shall call her blessed. Unquote. But in no respect can she be elevated to occupy the place of Christ himself, or even be elevated above Jesus Christ. She was humble and obedient, and she needed a Savior. And I will go into that within a moment. She was humble and obedient, and she needed a Savior, like the rest of mankind. Luke chapter 1, verse 47. He made things clear. Quote, whosoever shall do the will of my Father who is in heaven, the same is my brother and sister and mother. Unquote. From Matthew 12, 50. Chapter 12, verse 50. Mary did his will, God's will, her son's will, because her son was God, which she knew. But going back to Luke 1, 47. I think this is very important that I'm going to read that to you. And I'm not going to read Luke 1:47. I'm going to read to you chapter 1, verse 46 through 55. This is very, very important. It is the moment when Mary visits her cousin Elizabeth, who is at that moment pregnant with the born later John the Baptist, who made the way free for the Lord in the spirit of Elijah. So we read in Luke chapter 1, verse 46 and continuing. Quote, and Mary said, my soul doth magnify the Lord, and my spirit hath rejoiced in God my Saviour. For he hath regarded the low estate of his handmaiden, for behold, from henceforth all generations shall call me blessed. For he that is mighty hath done to me great things, and holy is his name. And his mercy is on them that fear him from generation to generation. He hath showed strength with his arm. He hath scattered the proud in the imagination of their hearts. He hath put down the mighty from their seats and exalted them of low degree. He hath filled the hungry with good things, and the rich he hath sent empty away. He hath holpen his servant Israel in remembrance of his mercy, as he spake to our fathers, to Abraham, and to his seed forever. Unquote. Now, Mary actually says a few very, very important things here that absolutely contradict all of the Roman Catholic teaching. Everything you need is Scripture. All you need is the Bible, the Word of God. She says, in verse 47, and my spirit hath rejoiced in God my Savior. So, how can Mary save anyone when she herself says that she has rejoiced in God her Savior, when she needs a Savior herself? You know, if Jesus committed any sin on this world, he could not complete his work on Calvary, because it was absolutely necessary that he was sinless. Only that's why he could take all the sins of all humanity on him, of all mankind. Otherwise he couldn't do it. That's why no priest, that's why no bishop, no cardinal, no pope can take your sins away. No man can take your sins away. Only Jesus Christ can take your sins away, because he is sinless. Mary knew that she was not sinless. Mary knew that she was not immaculate. That's why her spirit rejoiced in God her Savior. For he hath regarded the low state of his handmaiden, continues verse 48 in Luke 1. Well, What does she say? The low estate of his handmaiden. Is that, are those the words of the Queen of Heaven? Are those the words of a woman who is above God? Who is the Mother of God, as the Roman Catholic Church wants you to believe it? The low estate of his handmaiden? Just read the Bible and all the answers come to you. For he that is mighty hath done to me great things, and holy is his name, not my name, his name. Just with these first three verses, Luke 1:46-48, we can unveil the lies of the Roman Catholic Church without any superstition, without any doubt, and the low estate of the handmaiden. This is so contrary to the teaching that Mary was some kind of a quote-unquote queen, queen of heaven, consolation of the afflicted, queen of angels, queen of the apostles, queen of the martyrs, all these names given to by the quote that I just read, Ricordio Religiosi, Turin, 1968. All this is an absolute contradiction to what the Word of God says. So what do you believe? The Word of God or the Word of man? Who are you giving allegiance to? The Pope, the Antichrist, or Jesus Christ? That's the question you have to ask yourself. So just to make my point, I will read this last paragraph once again. Mary has the honored and distinguished place which Scripture accords her. All generations shall call her blessed, but in no respect can she be elevated to occupy the place of Christ himself. She was humble and obedient, and she needed a Savior, like the rest of mankind, as we just read in the first chapter of Luke. He made things clear by a quote of Matthew chapter 12, verse 50, "Whosoever shall do the will of my Father who is in heaven, the same is my brother and sister and mother." Unquote. Mary did his will, not the will of the Pope, not the will of a Pharisee, not the will of a Sadducee, the will of God. Now the next part in the book is called John Paul II and Mary. John Paul II has his personal motto, Totus Tuus, meaning totally yours, but it applies to Mary and not to Jesus. Indeed, at his enthronement he proclaimed, quote, "All that I have is thine, my queen and my mother." Unquote. After the attempt on his life in 1981, Time magazine reported under the heading, "It's like shooting God," that on his way to hospital, he softly murmured, "Madonna, Madonna," in Polish, as you can read in Time magazine on the 25th of May 1981. 1 year after the assassination attempt, he went to the Marian Shrine of Fatima in Portugal to thank Mary for saving his life. More details of the part the Pope believes Our Lady of Fatima played in saving his life and will play in his future follow on when we look at the importance of Fatima later on in this chapter. And I again can't help to make a little comment here. If anybody thinks that this assassination attempt was just an attempt that failed, no, that was just a show they played. And we will see later why. And I will later explain that. But it is very important to understand that the assassination was just a show for the people. In April 1987, the Pope launched the Marian Year to a global TV audience estimated perhaps generously at 1.5 billion people on the world. 2 months later, at a mass for several hundred thousand people at Lodz in Poland, he prayed to the Virgin Mary for religious freedom in the world. In May 1988, in the cathedral at Lima, he consecrated Peru to Our Lady of Evangelization, anticipating the decade of evangelization to follow. In Rome in August 1988, in a ceremony to mark the end of the Marian year, the Pope proclaimed, quote, "This is the opportunity to start a Marian walk towards the year 2000. We must walk together with Mary," unquote. He was speaking in Italian on that occasion. The international magazine New Evangelization 2000, published by Tom Forrest in the Vatican to promote the decade of evangelization, featured the Madonna with Child as the front piece to its special January 1991 edition. Quote, "The decade of evangelization begins," unquote. So that's the title of this front piece. An earlier edition reprinted the Pope's Angelus Prayer of Mission Sunday, October 23rd, 1988. Quote, "May Mary be the model to which people of God look in order to live out their missionary commitment. Let us ask her with trust to intercede with her Son to obtain for the Church a new Pentecost, a new missionary advent for the Jubilee year 2000 and for the beginning of the third millennium of the Christian faith," unquote. In the United States of America, the papal visit and the enormous publicity generated by it added currency to the claim made for Mary's special place as her role as an intercessor and her share in the divinity of her Son. Here in Europe, we can see a similar picture emerging. Pilgrimages to the Marian shrines at Lourdes in France, Fatima in Portugal, Knock, I don't know where that is, Medjugorje in Yugoslavia, and Walsingham, wildly advertised in the press and featured on television, attract millions of worshippers from all over the world. The shrine of Our Lady of Czechstokova, with its famous image of the Black Madonna, has played its part, very visibly among all the great events reported from Poland in the international press during the last few years. Lech Walesa's photograph with the image has been widely syndicated, and the Pope has twice visited the shrine, which is about 200 kilometers away from his hometown of Krakow in Poland. We come to Walsingham and Mary. Our Lady of Walsingham, parent shrine to 180 other shrines in Church of England churches, was host in September 1988 to the BBC program Songs of Praise, watched by up to 8 million viewers. 1988 has been a special pilgrimage organized for some 60 bishops of the Lambeth Conference, as well as the third consecutive pilgrimage from Parliament. Encouraged by the example of former Archbishop of Canterbury, Robert Runcie, senior bishops turn out to lead the pilgrimage year after year. Archbishop Runcie, who was president of the Ecumenical Society of the Blessed Virgin Mary, and who, according to Time magazine, was probably willing to risk more for the sake of unity than any of his predecessors, was an enthusiast for Walsingham and its role in leading the Anglican Church into Catholicism of the Roman kind, unquote. Very, very important last few words. And its role in leading the Anglican Church into Catholicism of the Roman kind. Now, who understands what Catholicism of the Roman kind is? Catholicism of the Roman kind is the turn and the emphasis laying on the evil Council of Trent. Every Catholic dogma proclaimed there, all the anathemas, the curses spoken out at that time, are still valid today. And Catholicism of the Roman kind is just another wording of Catholicism in the spirit of the Council of Trent. And the Council of Trent was the council of the Counter-Reformation. The first council started and all the time held by the, in 1540, just 5 years before this council started, founded Jesuit order. Catholicism of the Roman kind. Read Catholicism in the Spirit of the Council of Trent. Walsingham worship includes the procession of a statue of the Virgin Mary, the processing and adoration of the Host or Blessed Sacrament, blessing with holy water, and the veneration and kissing of a relic of the True Cross. Those who question Catholic renewal point also to the renewed enthusiasm among many charismatics for the Rosary, with its repetitious Hail Marys and 10 times as many prayers to Mary as to God the Father, and none to Jesus Christ. Certainly there are no obvious signs that the worship of Mary has been effectively shut down by the renewal. On the contrary, new doctrines are under discussion and indications are that a new proclamation about her may be forthcoming soon. Mary Mediatrix and Co-Redemptrix are already falling into the new tradition of this, the 20th century. Quote, as no man goes to the Father except by the Son, so no man goes to the Son except by his mother. Unquote. Papal Encyclical of 1897. Where do we find that? In the true Word of God. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and nobody comes to the Father but by me. And the Roman Catholic Church even acknowledges that here, but says, no man goes to the Son except by his mother. Now, do you really think that Jesus was that stupid that if there was a mediator needed between him and man, that he wouldn't tell us? The Bible says explicitly, there is no other name given among men on the earth by which we must be saved but the man Jesus Christ. He is the only way. He is the mediator between man and the Father. There is no biblical mediator between man and Jesus Christ. It is the personal relationship Bible-believing, Jesus-following Christians have with Jesus Christ that is that mediator, if you can call it that. That personal relationship opens up the possibility for us to talk to Jesus Christ directly, to the Son, to speak to the Father through his Son. Because we cannot address the Father directly because of our fallen state. But Jesus takes that away for us and makes us righteous. Our belief in him makes us righteous in the eyes of God. Therefore do we need him. Nowhere in the Bible is it stated that no man goes to the Son except by his mother. That is only an invented Roman Catholic teaching with the goal to venerate the mother, to make people accept the role the Roman Catholic Church wants to give to Mary all over the world. Therefore, you need papal encyclicals and Roman Catholic teaching like this. Vatican II declared Mary Mother of the Church. In his March 1987 encyclical Redemptoris Mater, the Pope explained that, quote, while Mary is in no sense a mediator between God and man, which is Christ's role alone, she constantly precedes the Church in her journey through human history and cooperates with Christ's work of salvation, unquote. Published in The Universe, 27th of March, 1987. So I don't think I have to make an extra comment. You understand where I come from and what I read so far and commented on so far. The next part in this chapter is called the Marian cult, and this is going to be interesting. The dogma of the Assumption and the Immaculate Conception of the Virgin Mary, both of which are relatively recent additions to tradition, have been established quickly in the Roman Catholic Church. Such is the ecclesiastical weight of papal decree and the discipline of the whole institution. The Marian cult is not part of the ARCIC or other ecumenical discussions. No, Marian cult is never part of the discussions. Catholic devotion to Mary is not negotiable. Of course it's not negotiable, because it's a doctrine of the Roman Catholic Church, and you cannot discuss what the infallible, quote-unquote, infallible Pope said about her. So, this whole Mary stuff never is part of any ecumenical discussions. You just have to take it, because when you leave it, you will not participate in this ecumenical discussions, and you are, by that, an enemy of the Church. Catholic devotion to Mary is not negotiable. The strength of reaction to Neil Kinnock's speech of 9th of April 1989, when its intended humor relating to the quote-unquote immaculate misconception and the quote-unquote assumption of the Blessed Margaret, clearly underlined just how important Mary is to Catholics in Britain. Bishop Alan Clark of East Anglia wrote to opposition leader Kinnock of the offence given by the completely insensitive use of one of the central beliefs of the Catholic faith. Cardinal Hume also wrote a strong-worded letter stressing the importance to the Catholic faith of the doctrines of the Assumption and the Immaculate Conception, as we can read in the Catholic Herald, 14th of April, 1989. It was noted that the indignation and the wave of protests from Catholic Church leaders all over the country over this insult to Mary was quite different from the restrained, dignified, and statesmanlike reaction of the Catholic leadership to the showing of the highly controversial and blasphemous film, Last Temptation of Christ. Now we come to the last part of this chapter, called Unity and Mary. And here it gets really crazy. The Pope proclaimed in Redemptoris Mater that, quote, Mary will help lead Christians to unity, unquote. But there seems to be a picture emerging that Mary may be the means for the uniting of all faiths under one umbrella. Now, I cannot let the sentence just go. I have to make at least a little comment. And you're going to ask yourself, how are they ever in the world are going to establish a one world religion? Well, this sentence just explained how they're going to do that. So I'm going to read it again. The Pope proclaimed in Redemptoris Mater that Mary will help lead Christians to unity. But there seems to be a picture emerging that Mary may be the means for the uniting of all faiths under one umbrella. And how can that be done? When you read The Two Babylons from Alexander Hislop, when you read Babylon Mystery Religion from Ralph Woodrow, which is on my channel, you can look that up, you understand that all religion, which is a man-made belief system, has its roots in Babylon. From Babylon, you have the root of Hinduism, Buddhism, Roman Catholicism. I do not for the moment include Islam, because Islam is an invention of Roman Catholicism. The Roman Catholic Church invented Islam. And that's why they have so many things in common, as we will also a little bit later see in the same part of this last part of this chapter here in the book. But all religion has its roots in Babylon. And we read before this little quote from Alexander Hislop from his books, from his book The Two Babylons, as you probably remember, where he said that, likewise, after the Tower of Babel, by many nations and peoples all over the world, in Egypt as Isis and Osiris, in India to this day as Isai and Iswara, in pagan Rome as Venus of Fortuna and Jupiter, even in Tibet, China, and Japan, the Jesuit missionaries were astonished to find the counterpart of Madonna and her child as devoutly worshipped as in papal Rome itself. So, all these religions have their roots in Babylon. So because they all have the same root, they have more in common than things that divide them. only biblical Christians divide the problems that we are talking about here. Well, I'm gonna go longer than an hour, I fear, here. Anyway, the point is, when it is said here, it seems to be a picture emerging that Mary may be the means of the uniting of all faiths under one umbrella. That's because all faiths, all religions, not faith, all religions have the veneration of mother and child worship in their religion. So when they have all that in common, it is not that difficult to unite them, right? And that's the difference with Bible-believing Christians, because they are not under the faith that have Mary or mother and child worship in their belief system. That's the difference between the Bible-believing Christians and all the other quote-unquote religions, man-made belief systems. That's why we should separate, as God said. Come out of her, my people, that you do not partake of her sins, and that you don't get from her plagues. Revelation 18, verse 4 is the one that I'm meaning of. And also speaking of that we should separate ourselves from the world, and of course, worldly religions. Now, ecumenical dialogue between Roman Catholicism and Islam is taking place in many non-Protestant countries. The Shrine of Fatima in Portugal, of great prophetic importance to Catholics, has also become important to Muslims. It is very often equated or confused with Fatima, the daughter of Muhammad, of whom the Prophet wrote, quote, "She is the most holy of all women in paradise, next to Mary," unquote. Muriel Spark relates that at Međugorje in Yugoslavia, some 2 months after the apparitions began in September 1981, Muslims joined with Orthodox and Catholics in the pilgrimages. Devout Catholics were deeply shocked. The Madonna is reported as saying, quote, "God is indivisible. It is not God, but believers who have caused the dreadful divisions in the world," unquote. Maybe I should reread this. God is indivisible, not indivisible, sorry, indivisible. God is indivisible. It is not God, but believers who have caused the dreadful divisions in the world, unquote. In the ecumenical spirit of our day, she is said to have pointed out that devout Roman Catholics seem to go out of their way to avoid contact with Orthodox and Muslims. Yet, nobody who refused to take other believers seriously was worthy of the name of Christian. Well, scrap that word Christian and put in place Catholic, and then I agree with it. By the way of underlining this difficult message, Our Lady singled out a Muslim woman called Pasha for special praise. Quote, "She is a true believer, a saintly woman. You should be more like her," unquote. A priest who had expressed skepticism about one of the proclaimed healings was corrected by the lady. Quote, "Tell that priest and others like him that it is they who are perpetuating the divisions in the world. Muslims, Orthodox, Catholics, to my son and myself, all are one. You are all my children," unquote. I don't have to get into this because I commented on this a few minutes before, right? Clearly the Madonna has no time for the separated brethren. My point too, also there. But it is easy to see why there is so much controversy within the Roman Catholic Church relating to the authenticity of Madonna's appearance at Međugorje. Quote, "Mary the Mother unquestionably has global appeal. She is alluring not only to Catholics, but represents a syncretistic goddess who is able to unite all faith, for her motherhood stirs the deepest yearnings of the human spirit. Indeed, when a pilgrim virgin, a statue of Our Lady of Fatima, toured Africa and Asia, millions flocked to venerate the statue and learn of Our Lady's peace plan from heaven. Muslims, Buddhists, Hindus, and Sikhs were particularly enthusiastic. The Muslims, who have a certain devotion to Our Lady and recognize her virgin birth and recognize her Immaculate Conception, were intrigued by the fact that Mary had appeared at Fatima, which was the name of Muhammad's favorite daughter and regarded by the Prophet as the highest woman in heaven after Our Lady. The Muslim chief of the Ismaili tribe in Mozambique placed a golden necklace about the statue's neck, saying, quote, "Thank you, Our Lady of Fatima, for the work of love you are accomplishing in Africa. We praise you together with the Almighty Allah." End quote. End of both quotes, actually, because that other one from Mary starting on was also a quote. There are so many things to say about this little thing here, but, you know that the Muslims occupied a big part of Spain during the Middle Ages, and they founded the city of Fatima, and do you think that that is a quote-unquote coincidence, that they found the city of Fatima, and there appears, quote-unquote, Our Lady of the Roman Catholics? You have to see the resemblance and the working together of Islam and Roman Catholicism. If you don't see that, you will never understand the whole ISIS situation that we have today in 2016. According to Mariologist John Heffert, more than 100,000 people witnessed the miracle of Fatima on the 13th of October 1917, although other writers estimate the number as nearer as 70,000. This was the sixth reported appearance of Our Lady of Fatima, who had appeared on the 13th day of each month that summer since the 13th of May to three Portuguese children: Lucia, aged 8, Jacinta, aged 6, and Francisco, also aged 8 years, and had promised to perform a miracle in October so that all may believe. Witnesses to what took place on that day were terrified by what they saw and hesitant and fearful in describing it afterwards. Apparently the sun at first appeared as a silver disk, and then suddenly a spectrum of multicolored light shot out in every direction and the sun appeared to spin madly on its axis like a gigantic wheel of fire, splashing its hues of red, yellow, blue and green on the rocks and trees and upturned faces of the astonished pilgrims. Three times it stopped, and then it resumed its mad dance. Then, as the cloud cringed in abject terror, the sun suddenly seemed to torn loose from the firmament. Down, down, down it plunged, zigzagging dizzling through the sky. Wails of "It's the end of the world!" and "Dear Lady, save us!" arose from the terrified multitude. Then, as suddenly as it had begun, the sun stopped its gyrations and returned to its post in the sky. As the trembling crowd recovered from its fright, cries of astonishment arose. Their garments, which had been soaked and mud-covered from the pelting rain that they had endured before the miracle, were miraculously dry. Whatever you want to believe of this so-called miracle, eh? During the spectacle, it continues, Mary is said to have appeared, holding a rosary and scapula, and identified herself as Our Lady of the Rosary, and asking that the rosary be prayed every day. Remember, 10 times more hailing Mary than the Father God, and not once mentioning Jesus Christ. In July, she had given the Church her directive for a world devotion and for the consecration of Russia to her Immaculate Heart. She is also quoted as saying that, quote, "many, many souls are going to hell because there's no one to make sacrifices for them," unquote. I just want to go in for a little second on the 13th of the month. We read here that the 13th of May, this apparition, the three Portuguese children had, and every 13th of the month it came again, and also that the Pope was shot on the 13th of the month. This is not a coincidence to me, because 13 is a very Kabbalistic and important number for the Jesuits, the Templars, the whole cabal, the whole people that so-called lead us. And that goes back to Friday, the 13th of October, 1307, when the Knights Templars were arrested all over France. That's because they think Friday the 13th is giving us a bad notion. But I don't go into that anymore. I think there are some things that you also have to see for yourself. A remarkable revelation from a 1990 book, The Keys of This Bluff, written by Professor Malachi Martin, who is described as a former Jesuit, you can have your doubts on that, is that Pope John Paul II believes in his own special destiny as directed by Our Lady of Fatima. Pope Paul II is convinced that he will be called in the 1990s to be the moral and spiritual leader of a world government. He is also sure that it was Our Lady of Fatima who spared his life from the assassination attempt on 13th of May 1981, for it was as he bent over to inspect an Our Lady of Fatima medal worn by a little girl on the anniversary of the first Fatima appearance that the two shots specifically aimed at his head passed over him. Are you gonna tell me that's a coincidence? That's all planned, because it all fits the plan. While he was recovering from the assassination attempt which had taken place on the official feast day of Our Lady of Fatima, oh, what a coincidence, he had a vision of things to come. In the vision, which apparently came from prayer and his total trust in Our Lady of Fatima, and was an exact repetition of what had taken place at Fatima on 13th of October 1917, the Virgin Mother told him that there would be a repeat of the Fatima miracle. She will intervene in the 1990s with signs and wonders, again involving the sun, which will authenticate John Paul's reign over the world for a short time of peace and prosperity before the return of Christ. Unquote from Malachi Martin, The Keys of This Blood. I hope you understand the powerful Kabbalah in relation to all the dates I just read here to you. In 1982, in obedience to the Fatima Directive and with a collegial consensus of the bishops of the world, Pope John Paul II reconsecrated Russia and the entire world to the Immaculate Heart of Mary. Now again, read Alexander Hislop's The Two Babylons, Chapter 7, The Image of the Beast, and you will understand much better than me just reading All Roads Lead to Rome right here to you. But we finish off with the last sentence here. In May 1991, Pope John Paul made his third papal visit to Fatima to again thank the Virgin Mary for saving his life, to tell the world how much the Mother of God is needed and that any renewal of the world could only take place in such a context. This is taken from The Universe, Sunday, 19th of May, 1991. So, even though I'm a little bit longer than the German reading, 1 minute, I finish now. I hope you enjoyed me reading chapter 3 of All Roads Lead to Rome about the Virgin Mary and the deception that is in there, especially when you compare it to the Bible. And we will go on with the next reading, chapter 4, which is called Tradition. I thank you all for listening and watching, and also for the comments in the comment section, if you have any, and any comment that requires an answer, I will provide it to you. So, Juggler 66 from Hour of the Truth, signing off. God bless you. Until next time. Bye-bye.
We, as Bible-believing Christians, we know that the hand that is behind ISIS, the hand that is behind Al-Qaeda, is the same hand that is behind the United States of America government, that is behind the European Union government, and that is behind all the armies in the world, and that is behind all these mercenary companies out in the world, like XE, or formerly called Blackwater, run by Knights of Malta, etc., etc. So this is something that you really have to understand. This is all just a theater. And the point is, where is this theater going to lead to? When you are a Bible-believing Christian, you know that in the end times, Jesus warned us in Matthew 24, there will be wars, wars, and rumors of wars. And we know that the Antichrist, by peace, will destroy many. And so on, and so on, and so on. I could start citing the whole Bible up and down right now with citations like this to tell you what it's all about. But I don't have to sing to the choir or preach to the choir. You, as Bible-believing Christians, already know that. So the only thing that I ask of you is don't be caught in their game. Because when you are and you play their game, you have to play by their rules. And their rules are not Christ's rules. So the only thing that I can advise you of is, okay, take that information in, what happens about there. Pray for the people that these victims are being taken good care of, and that they are just deceived people, that they maybe have a chance. By going through this situation, maybe they have a way to find to Christ in this way. Maybe they have a way to find to the real truth. I mean, these people are Muslims and coming from Muslim countries and coming to so-called, quote-unquote, Christian countries. Of course, the Roman Catholic Church is not Christian. Of course, the Protestant churches today don't preach any protest anymore. All right, I know that. But still, here and there, it is possible that a grain falls on the ground that can fall on fruitful ground, even with these refugees and the whole situation that is coming up. And that is the hope that we should have as Bible-believing Christians, and that is the prayer that we should use every day when we address our Lord, to pray for our enemies as we pray for our friends. Because Jesus said, love your enemies and love your neighbor.